Hello YouTube, today I'm talking about the philosophy that I apply to my upper back training. I'm not going to be mentioning the posterior chain or the lower back because these will get their own video. I made a video about the topic of abs in the past, so it's a series that I want to continue. The installments will be few and far between, but eventually it will complete the way I treat my body when it comes to bodybuilding. So, in my opinion and for me, the upper back is the most underrated, undeveloped, and undertrained muscle group for natural lifters. And you can truly see that when you look at pro bodybuilders, because that's just my opinion, but I've always found that in reality, steroids tend to be, training in liquid form, meaning that they develop muscles regardless of what you do. And you see that with pro bodybuilders who have insanely developed upper backs that don't even look human, meaning that their other body parts are massive, of course, but they still have a human quality to them, meaning that they look like a jacked, bigger, much more ripped and vascular bicep, for example. But for the upper back, it looks like a different beast. It's a different animal altogether. You have certain qualities that are developed immensely, certain shapes, certain roundness that pop out of nowhere, and you see that and you think, how is that possible? Well, it's possible because the entirety of the upper back is being trained, because the drugs that circulate in the system grow everything, regardless. It doesn't discriminate, it just grows things. But that's actually a good thing, because it teaches us naturals that we are not doing our homework, we're not training our upper back properly. And there are multiple aspects to that. First off, the upper back can take immense amounts of volume. And the issue is that a lot of people hear that and think, oh, I'm going to do a ton of deadlift and rows. You would be wrong, because the issue is that what's going to limit you on those movements is never the upper back. It's always your posterior chain and your lumbar spine. A lot of people will snap their lower back way before they hurt their upper back because they're not really training the upper back. They're doing a full body movement. A row is a full body movement. It trains your posterior chain. It trains your upper back. It's akin to a deadlift. So you need to do certain movements that isolate the back. And I can tell you that the second you do a movement that truly isolates the upper back, you will be humbled, not only by the sensations, because for the first time in your life, you will feel like you're pulling with your back, and two, because you will be weak. A lot of people I know who can row 275, you put them on ring rows, they can barely get 10 reps, because you're actually pulling with the muscles of the upper back. You're not swinging, you're not using any movement. And that's humbling, but that's also the way to go, because that's how you train a muscle. You put tension to it. That's the point of isolation. Of course, isolation with the upper back is sort of a joke, because it's tough to just pinpoint one part of the upper back and say, you're training. The entirety of the upper back is going to train. But depending on the movement, you can really isolate a portion. And if you think about it, the fact that you cannot really isolate a slight muscle group means that you're going to get diffuse tonnage. So the entire upper back is going to get developed as well. That's a good point because it saves you time. So why not? So that's, to me, first one of the things that really limits people, because they will have in their head the thought that they work their upper back and they won't see the result because they're not really working their upper back. And I was one of them. And it's usually, as I said, the fact that you're usually training the legs and not the upper back. And also because on movements that recruit the upper back, like rows, like pull-ups, like something, any type of machine, people pull with their either legs or they pull with their arms. People don't know how to pull with their back. I can tell you that when you do pull-ups, even chin-ups, you should scarcely feel your arms. The arms are ropes. And yes, there is an amount of elbow flexion, so you will get some bicep development and forearms up in here, but it's mostly back. You should really feel like you're pulling with your back. And for people who've ever rowed a boat before, you know that's how you row. What moves is the upper back. You're not pulling, you're not rowing a boat like this. You're not doing an elbow flexion. It's the same for the musculature that's back there. That's how it gets developed. So that's what I apply in my training. I have a lot of movements that only focus on the upper back and nothing else. And of course, for progression, I also do my rows. But I don't think of my rows as an upper back movement. It's a back builder in general. In terms of philosophy that I apply for my training as well, I like heavy movements. I train heavy a lot, but the heavy movements that I do tend to fall in that category, meaning that it's diffuse tonnage for the entire posterior chain and upper back. deadlifts, rows, all sorts of deadlift variations, pulling variations. When I want to really target the upper back and certain portions of them that are weak, like the lats, for example, that are pathetic for me, I do pull-ups, tons of pull-ups. But when I do it like this, I do high volume. I do still focus on intensity, but the volume quality is my focus. I want to get a ton of it. And you will find that in terms of intra-workout ability to go back to baseline and resilience, the ability of the muscle to stay endurant, to replicate effort, to recover, the upper back is unmatched for multiple reasons. One, there's no annoying tendon that can be irritated. When you have something irritated of the upper of that limits you in upper back training, usually it's the lower back, your knees, it might be your SI joint, it might be your shoulder joint, it might be your bicep joint. It's really the upper back. And in terms of injury rate, it's tougher to injure the upper back because it's like a pack of meat. Yes, you can pull something. I've heard of people pulling something. But I know of certain parts of the upper back that I've never heard of anyone hurting, like the traps. I've never heard anyone pulling a trap. So in terms of raw ability to just take punishment and grow from it, the upper back is amazing. Of course, if you disregard what I told you before, the advice of how to train the upper back, it's not going to work. You're going to be limited by something else much sooner than you would like, and you will never reach the amount of damage that you could inflict to the upper back if you knew how to apply yourself. So that's another thing. And then I also do what I would call special movements. And they're not really special, it's just that they've been forgotten by most people. And I think that the best example of that is the pullover. I have never in my life felt a stretch on the lats quite like a pullover. It is amazing. If you don't do them, please do them. Do them high volume, do them medium intensity for progression. You have to do them. The expansion of the ribcage in the upper back, to me, is something that's really lacking in bodybuilding nowadays. And it's the reason why natural bodybuilders struggle to have a big yoke, a big upper back. And then you have weighted stretch. And to me, weighted stretch changed my approach to upper back training forever. I will make a full video on weighted stretch, on the dangers of weighted stretch, because there are dangers. But in terms of raw benefits, of time gain, and on stress put on certain part of the upper back, understand that any and every movement you do that gets you gains for the upper back is weighted stretch. If people tell you deadlift, grow your back, a deadlift is a weighted stretch. You don't have any amount of shoulder or elbow flexion. You're just pulling a weight. The only thing that's happening is that the torso angle makes it so that the stretch of the upper back is changed, but it's what makes it grow. So if you like deadlifts for the upper back, you're doing weighted stretch. If you do rows, a large portion of the row is when you catch the weight on the way down and then you pull it. That's weighted stretch. If you do shrugs, you shrug it and then you let it go down. That's weighted stretch. In reality, a negative is weighted stretch. That's the reason why when I see people say weighted stretch don't work, it makes me laugh because it shows how dogmatic and how incapable of applying analysis they are to training, because weighted stretch is everywhere. And the best example of weighted stretch is weighted stretch for the upper back. For the traps, if you stay with a vertical torso, if you lean in with a little bit of hip flexion, the mid and lower traps get stretched. The real delt gets stretched. Even the lats, you can get weighted stretch for the lats with a heavy weighted pull-up. All of that is the name of the game. And if you don't, if you can't grow your traps, do yourself a favor. Start doing weighted stretch. That being said, I personally like weighted stretch in higher rep ranges because even though partials tend to be safe, if you load them three times the amount that you can deadlift, of course you're going to hurt yourself. So be careful. I'll make a full guide about that. But for me, these three aspects I just described make up the trifecta of what I think about when I train my upper back. It is isolation, it is volume, and it is smart application of what is actually going to grow that body part. And I've made some pretty good progress. So I do think that the update to the Road to a Bigger Back playlist is going to come in the next few months, so I can show you the small details I modified. I can show you the mass I gained on my lat, especially that the difference is night and day. It's insane. And I'm quite excited to show it to you guys. But that's going to be that for my philosophy when it comes to training upper back. And I think that if you apply it in your training, you will see great success. Let me know in the comments what you think, and have a good day.